And this is my my covenant with them when I take away their sins. In respect to the gospel, they are enemies on your account, but in respect to the election, they are beloved because of the patriarchs. For the gifts and the call of God are irrevocable. Just as you once disobeyed God, but now have received mercy because of their disobedience, so they now have disobeyed in order that by the virtue of the mercy shown to you, they too may now receive mercy. For God delivered all to disobedience that he might have mercy upon all. Oh, the depth of the riches and the wisdom and knowledge of God, how inscrutable are his judgments, and how unsearchable are his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor, or who has given him anything that he may not be repaid? For from him and through him and for him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen.
Praise and blessings to Jesus. Now, normally what I do from year to year on the Feast of the Holy Trinity is to give a sermon precisely about the Trinity, but theologically. To speak about circumcision, miraculous, and all these other words. Which often meant at the end of the sermon that there was kind of a communal question of what the heck was that? The intention wasn't primarily to learn and to pass theological knowledge of the Trinity, but for us to come to an awareness of the profound mystery that is God. We become comfortable with the notion of the Trinity, the way we become comfortable with the crucifixion, because we see the crucifix all the time, and it's usually pretty, and silver, or gold, it's all very nice. It's not bleeding, it's not dying. We do something similar with the Trinity. But after today, what I'd like you to do is to note two things from this Gospel of St. Matthew. This Gospel, as I mentioned to you a few weeks ago, in the context that all the Gospels end in quite different ways, we'd expect them to finish the story by talking about the Ascension and Pentecost. But in fact, St. Matthew doesn't finish with either one of those. He finishes in the mystery of the church. So the reading that we have today, in fact, is the very end of the Gospel, at the last line. We're not told even in Galilee where this took place, except that it's just in the Galilee, on a mountain, that our Lord has specified to the apostles to meet up at. And of course, famously tells them that he has received all power in heaven and on earth, and he sends them out. Oftentimes you'll see this text referred to as the Great Commission. He is sent, the Messiah is sent by his Father, and the Messiah in turn sends the apostles, which is what the word apostle means. In English we say missionary. It is one who is apostolating, it's one who is sent out. But one of the things that I'd like you to note here, the two are, what is being promulgated here? And the second is, who is being promulgated? Who is being published? Who is being made known? So what is being known? The thing to note here is that in this preaching of the Gospel, our Lord says, go and make disciples of all nations. Now, disciple, the word is just from the Latin. It means learning. Dicere in Latin is to learn. A disciple is merely one who learns. And the word discipline, which has something of a bad taste for the 21st century, only means the method of learning. That's all the discipline means. So the disciples must be disciplined in order to learn. Or the learners must be learned in order to learn. We try to make it a problem with our language. It's part Greek, it's part Latin, it's part German, and everything else in between. So when he's saying go out and make those disposed to learn, he doesn't say individuals. This is an important point. The Protestantism is all about the individual. It's all about me. It's all about everything that individually. But clearly in the Catholic mindset, and this Gospel is very clear, they are sent forward to convert nations, not just individuals. But those nations include communities, cultures, and societal norms which are transformed. That in itself can lead to a whole sermon. This understanding that the Gospel is preached to the peoples of the earth, and of course the peoples are made of individuals. But the same way that the Messiah came to take away primarily the sin of Adam and Eve, and thereby also restore the grace to every individual. So the Gospel is also preached to nations, to peoples, to cultures, in which individuals also hear. And of course, unfortunately, some individuals refuse. Whether they come to the light or not, they are free. The second aspect of this preaching of the Gospel is done through the sacred mysteries. It's not just done through prayer. It's done by the conferral and the confecting of the sacred mysteries. Here specifically our Lord speaks about baptism, that they are to be cleansed of their sins spreading of the gospel. The gospel is learned from person to person, from generation to generation, between people. No one is going to receive grace from a website. And though we venerate the scriptures themselves, the incense and everything else in our gods, and it is the divine word of God, it is something which lays dormant and has no life if it is not the life of the gospel which is being preached, in which those scriptures are taught. And on the third point of what is being promulgated, it is doctrine, it is teaching. And another aspect of the 21st century and the late 20th century, that we find the word dogma, doctrine, to many people offensive. Doctrine only means teaching. Dishere is to learn, docere is to teach, disciples learn, and doctors docet. The word doctor doesn't mean physician, it means teacher. That's its original meaning. That's why someone who practices medicine can be called doctor, and someone who is a doctor in philosophy with his PhD is also doctor. It means teacher. And part of this promulgation of what is being promulgated, our Lord says, and you are to teach them everything that I have commanded you, and that they are to observe these things, to do them. We live in an age in which we are, as they use the term these days, cafeteria Catholics. We pick and choose amongst the catechism what we actually want to believe. You can tell that really by the fact that numbers go up and down on the Sunday Mass. Who's here, who's not here? Oh, well, it's a nice weekend. Let's go have a picnic. God will understand. Instead of the understanding that on the eighth day, the first day of the week, which is the day of the Lord, this is something which is seriously of an obligation to us. And that's your opinion, Father. The doctrinal aspect of the church is also an objective aspect of what is being promulgated. So that it is to nations, through the sacred mysteries, and through a teaching. Given to us. That is the what being promulgated in this gospel today. And the last point is of the who. What is being communicated is not just those things. Those things are scaffolding. They are a structure in which there is a communication of a person. And that's why when our God and our Lord says to the apostles, if you baptize them in the name, one power, one divinity, you baptize them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. This revelation of who God is the primary thing which is communicated in the gospel. God is communicating who he is, because this has to do with God. Or with the supernatural aspect of it, what we call charity. Love is something which is very profound, but which moves us towards communication. Any of you who are married know this. And if communication breaks down, marriage breaks down. When we initially love, we are drawn to something. At the age of 20, it's usually pretty sexual. We're drawn to something rather physical. But love is meant to mature as we are first drawn to something which is rather superficial. We are drawn of a desire to know more about the beloved, the one that we love. This is why, in the days of our courtship and dating, we can sit around for hours discussing our second grade teacher, the color of my wagon when I was eight, what we did in the family. No one else cares at all of what color your wagon was. But the person who's sitting across the table all doe-eyed, looking at you, just loves this. Because you're giving them all of these details about the person that they love. And of course, that communication is meant to develop. what God is doing when he communicates to us his personal life. Now, for those who are married, human beings, if we're healthy, we all have arms and legs, heads, bodies. We have certain things about our nature that we can just simply know by looking externally. But if we don't communicate what actually goes on within this individual, we do not know the person. By observing from the outside, you can have certain ideas. But if we remain at that surface, we never not knowing the individual person, we lose that grasp of what we are meant to love. It's like saying to all the men who are here, you're married to a woman. Well, that's fine. Or to all the women, you're married to a man. But there's an individual man that you are married to. There's an individual person that your wife is. And this communication of personality is something which, as actually as generations go on, we seem to lose the grasp on more and more. We might have a Facebook page where we put all the best pictures of the way we think we look best. Because nobody puts up a crummy picture of them looking like they just crawled out from underneath the crawl space of the house. We put what we want people to see. But that's not a communication of who I am. It's advertising. And in the mystery of the Trinity, we have the Messiah who comes to us. Why this feast day is the end of the season of announcements. Christmas, the Epiphany, the Great Lent, the Resurrection. And we come to this Epiphany because of what this is in the Messiah, in our Lord Jesus Christ, is the revelation of the divine Son in his glorious resurrection. And in that glorious resurrection and in his teaching, he has communicated to us that God is in a relationship or desires to have a relationship to us as dead. This is what shocked the Israelites at the time. It wasn't simply calling him Father. He's calling him Abba. Abba. Abba is the equivalent of Papa, Daddy. Yeah. And to tell this to the Israelites who stood in awe before that burning mountain on Mount Sinai, and to say, but God really, truly is to you and desires you to be reciprocating love as Papa. And this relationship within God, of one God, eternal, who then communicates his charity in Pentecost, and this presence of the Holy Spirit within us, and within the church, and within us what we call the human saint. This is the food that is being here. The structure, the doctrine, the mysteries, they are all simply a structure to communicate God himself. And this is an important point just simply to leave you with. Because in this day and age, we tend to kind of have mushy thinking. And we will say often, for the Jews, the Muslims, the Christians, they all worship the same God. And to some extent, that's true, historically. But that's the equivalent of saying, because you men are married to women, you're all basically married to the same woman. Or to the women, you're all basically married to the same man. It's kind of absurd, right? Because you're married to the individual person. You're not married to a generic thing called man. There is a single creator of divinity, the origin of all things, God. And so anyone that worships a single divinity would be worshiping God. But to say for that reason that we all worship the same God is to say you're all married to the same woman. Obviously is silly. It's the equivalent of saying that God puts on a baseball cap that says Father, Son, and Spirit on it for Christians, and then takes it off for Muslims and Jews, and it's just the Lord God. The one God has revealed to us who he is personally. It is not in our option to say, no, that is unimportant. I don't care who you are, we just want to worship God. We absurd philosophical, theological period of time. And we have to clarify our thinking. It'd be the equivalent of having your husband start telling you about the color of his writing and saying, no, that's a stupid detail, I don't care. Most marriages didn't last very long, did they? You didn't want to know about the person. And so that's just simply our last point, that what is communicated is also who God is. And within that whole structure of doctrine and mysteries and that promulgation to nations, we have this profound mystery that God reveals himself interiorly of who he is personally in order that we ourselves may reciprocate in return, love for love, charity for charity. So on this day, let us ask God that he increase our faith and this charity and the desire to know God more profoundly in our prayer and in our catechism and the knowledge that we have of him. In the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
purified and received in hypocrisy and united in the bond of love and peace, through our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, may we give one another the greeting of peace with all we can. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, who is good, life-giving, and constant standing with you, now and forever.
Cool. have committed with the wrathful knowledge.
That the Father and God forgive us of the departure, for that your blessed name be glorified in us in all things. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was in now, shall be forever. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you.
saints may we obtain to share in the heavenly reward, the grace of your only Son, his love for all people. Glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, who is good, life-giving and consubstantial with you, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Jesus our Lord, bless us, protect us, and guide us on the path of life. Favorably remember the departed of those who have shared in this Eucharist that was offered upon this divine altar. Grant protection to the living, bless them with hope, with the prayers.